day and greetings to you. I'd like to give a special greetings to my church members of the Glen Huddley and the Fern Tree Gully Seventh-day Adventist churches. I hope that you're all doing well, being well this past week. I'd also like to give my greetings to anybody else who's watching as well. Thank you for taking the time to view this video. Well, over the last few months and the weeks ahead, the health of our planet Earth has come into sharp focus. We saw the billionaires launching themselves into space at enormous cost. Why did they do this? The cynics saw this as mine is bigger than yours vanity projects of billionaires whose wealth exploded massively throughout the pandemic that destroyed the lives and livelihoods of millions of people. One of these space billionaires, Jeff Bezos, the founder of Amazon and Origin Blue, has declared his vision that we can have a trillion humans in the solar system, which means we have 1,000 Mozarts and 1,000 Einsteins. This would be an incredible civilization. Not to be outdone, fellow space billionaire Elon Musk, the founder of Tesla and SpaceX, wants to make humanity multiplanetary and plans to land 1 million people on Mars by 2050 and establish a permanent colony there. Meanwhile, closer to home, the rest of the world's attention is very much on planet Earth, with COP26 starting in a few weeks. Here's a brief explainer.
COP26.
We're just weeks away now from COP26.
You've probably heard the words COP26 quite a lot by now.
It is crucial that these meetings in Glasgow have success.
The climate conference will see tens of thousands of people from almost every country arrive in Glasgow to witness supposedly historic agreements on climate change.
197 countries are gearing up to attend. It is the biggest climate event since the Paris Agreement was signed in 2015.
COP stands for Conference of the Parties. The United Nations have been holding climate change summits for the last three decades, and this will be the 26th. They are attended by heads of state, climate experts and campaigners, and their purpose is to produce an international response to the climate emergency. The UK will co-host the 12-day event with Italy and take over Glasgow's SEC Centre.
We either rise up and tackle climate change together, or else we sink together into the mire. This year at COP26 will be the moment at which the world chooses which of those two fates awaits us.
To understand why COP26 is so important, we need to look back at COP21, which is when the Paris Agreement was signed in 2015.
The Paris summit was the largest gathering of world leaders in history. For the first time ever, nearly every country on Earth agreed to work together to limit global warming to well below 2 degrees.
We do need to take action this year and make sure that at COP26, we are able to credibly say that we have kept 1.5 degrees alive.
The UN has said without drastic action, the world is on course to break through that target within a decade.
Crucially, when all those countries signed the Paris Agreement, they didn't have to say exactly what they'd do to meet their commitments.
At COP26, they'll have to present their plans, known as Nationally Determined Contributions, or NDCs. The success of the conference will be judged by how ambitious and binding these plans are.
Looks like an interesting conference coming up. Watch this space. As Christians, how should we relate to environmental issues? Is God a greenie? Well, let's have a look in the Bible, see what it has to tell us. After God created the world in 6 days, he gave these instructions to the newly created Adam and Eve in Genesis 1, verse 28. Then God blessed them, Adam and Eve, and said, "Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and govern it. Reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, and all the animals that scurry along the ground." God commanded Adam and Eve to rule or reign over his creation. This was the creation that he himself described as good, as joyous, as pleasant, and desirable. But there was more to it than that. Let's read Psalm chapter 8 and verse 6. "You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet." God put his perfect works, his accomplishments, and he put them under our feet. The symbolism there is quite amazing. The works of his hands, his creation, what he made, put under our feet. In Bible times, that was considered the dirtiest part of the body, and so only the lowest servants washed the feet of people. You may recall that Jesus washed the feet of his disciples, and that's called the service or the ordinance of humility. Well, before that, God humbled himself at creation by putting the works of his hands under our feet. And so, by putting his works under our feet, we are to reign benevolently. We are to look after the creation that God has given to us. If someone makes a handmade gift, we treasure it more because we know that they've put in thought, they've put in time, and so it is to be treasured. That's the same with God's creation. It is to be treasured. He made it by hand, and then he put it under our feet to rule and to take care of it. So besides ruling and reigning, does the Bible have anything else to say about our relationship to the earth and the things in it? Well, you might be surprised by what we find in the next section. The poem Trees by Joyce Gilmer begins with these famous lines. I think that I shall never see a poem lovely as a tree. As you can see, I'm very fortunate to have some nice trees in my front yard. However, in times of war, trees are often destroyed, whether it be by bombs and armaments, or whether it's destroyed on purpose because the enemy has a chance to hide in the foliage. However, God had something very interesting to say in Deuteronomy chapter 20 and verses 19 and 20. When you are attacking a town and the war drags on, you must not cut down the trees with your axes. You may eat the fruit, but do not cut down the trees. Are the trees your enemies that you should attack them? You may only cut down trees that you know are not valuable for food. Use them to make the equipment you need to attack the enemy town until it falls. Isn't that interesting? In times of war, the armies should not cut down food-bearing trees. This would not be right. Instead, they could only cut down non-food-bearing trees, and then only for making the equipment that they needed, not just wanton destruction. And what about animals? Does God care any less about animals than trees? Well, definitely not. In the Ten Commandments, no less, God says in Exodus 20 and verse 10, But the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or nor daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. So Sabbath was made not just for us as people, but also for the animals as well. God was just as concerned about the welfare of animals as he was concerned about the welfare of us. And so he also included them in the Sabbath rest. His care for the animals is emphasized in Jonah chapter 4 and verse 11. And should I not have concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and also many animals? So God was concerned not only for the people in the great city of Nineveh, but also for the animals that were in there as well. And so he sent Jonah to save the city, the people, and the animals. Finally, God takes note of how we care for animals. We can see this in Proverbs chapter 12 and verse 10. The righteous care for the needs of their animals, but the kindest acts of the wicked are cruel. Animals are not just to be treated for their utilitarian value, for milk or eggs or for their meat. Instead, we should take care of the animals and take care of their needs as well, because this is the hallmark of a truly righteous person. In our next section, I'll just have some concluding thoughts. Apart from his son Jesus, the greatest gift that God gave to us was actually the earth and the environment and all the beauty of nature. He handmade it, and then he put it under our feet to rule over and to reign in a righteous and a fair manner. So is God a greenie? Well, no. Is God green? Absolutely yes. Now, I know that many Christians are understandably a bit uncomfortable with some of the almost religious elements of the green movement. However, this does not mean that we should just stand on the sidelines and have nothing to say or do about the destruction and mistreatment of the environment. To do this would be a travesty and an abdication of our rulership and governing over the planet Earth. One of the most interesting verses in the Bible about the final judgment is found in Revelation chapter 11 and verse 18. The nations were filled with wrath, but now the time of your wrath has come. It is time to judge the dead and reward your servants, the prophets, as well as your holy people and all who fear your name, from the least to the greatest. Clearly, this verse is describing the final judgment, talks about rewards for God's people. However, I left out the last part of the verse. Let's read it now. It is time to destroy all who have caused destruction on the earth. God notices and God takes note of how we care for the earth that He has created and that He has given to us to rule over and to take care of. And so in the final judgment, our actions towards the earth will be part of the judgment. And so let's be amongst those who are taking care of the earth and not amongst those who are destroying it. I'd like to pray for you now. And after the prayer, please stay for one of my favourite hymns and songs, Morning Has Broken. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Dear Father, I thank you for the beautiful earth and all that is in it that you have created. Dear Father, you have given us a great gift, and even though we know it has been marred by sin, it's still a great place to be in. Dear Father, your earth is not being taken care of properly, and many things are happening to it. I pray, Father, that we as Christians will take care and be worthy rulers of the works of your hands that you have put under your feet. So please be with the viewer, Father, and as we all try to work for the betterment of your earth and for your honour and glory who created it. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for watching the video. Till next week, God bless, take care. Please stay and watch Morning Has Broken. Bye for now.
Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. The rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, prays every morning. God's recreation of the new day. Morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world.